Pentecost, as we begin 6 months of the ordinary Sundays of the church year. That means that we have no more festivals or high holy days for the next 6 months as we follow through the life, teaching, and ministry of Christ. Let us sing our opening hymn number 518, the tune is 528, I believe. Oh, praise ye the Lord.
Setting the captives free. Hear the word of the Lord. Looking at those who were around him, Jesus said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother." And may we just turn and give a good morning to those brothers and sisters and mothers around us. Say welcome to church this morning. Lovely to see so many here on time. Morning, good morning.
Good morning.
I think this is the most on-time congregation in the world. Well done. Thank you. Let us turn to page one in the green prayer book, as our custom is. We greet one another with the Trinitarian greeting. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. We declare together, glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, You take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. The Lord be with you. We turn to the collect for today. I think we all know where it is, on the bulletin on page 1, as we pray together. O God, from whom all good proceeds, grant that by your inspiration we may think those things that are right, and by your merciful guiding may do them. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the Old Testament reading by Henry.
Henry and Elizabeth.
Hedwig.
Little.
The Old Testament reading is taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 3, verses 8 to 15. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees in the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Henry. And famously, this last verse here in Genesis 3:15 is the first hint of the promised Saviour way back in the beginning of the Old Testament. We call it the proto or the first evangel, the first good news, that one will come who will strike the head of the serpent. Let us join together as we do in the psalm, as we say it from side to side by whole verse, beginning on this side. "Out of the depths have I called to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears consider well the voice of my supplication. For there is forgiveness with you, therefore you shall be feared. My soul waits for the Lord, more than watchmen for the morning, more than the watchmen for the morning. With him there is plenteous redemption, and he shall redeem Israel from all their sins. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. The epistle reading is by Eileen.
Good morning. The epistle reading is 2 Corinthians 4:13-5:1. Just as we have the same spirit of faith that is in accordance with Scripture, "I believed and so I spoke," we also believe and so we speak, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and will bring us with you into his presence. Yes, everything is for your sake, so that grace, as it extends to more and more people, may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So we do not lose heart. Even though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure, because we look not at what can be seen, but at what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Indeed, house in the heaven. Let us stand and sing our gradual hymn number 20. It's called Old 100. This is the setting of Psalm 100, as we sing All People That on Earth Do Dwell. Family heard it, they went out to restrain him, for people were saying,
He has gone out of his mind. And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem said, He has Beelzebul, and by the ruler of the demons he casts out demons. And he called them to him and spoke to them in parables. How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but his end has come. And no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his property without first tying up the strong man. Then, indeed, the house can be plundered. Truly I tell you, people will be forgiven for their sins and whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit can never have forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they had said, He has an unclean spirit. Then his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, Your mother and your brothers and sisters are outside asking for you. And he replied, Who are my mother and my brothers? And looking at those who sat around him, he said, Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Let us pray. Lord, we pray that we may be counted among your family, that we may be adopted into your family, and that we may find ourselves brothers and sisters to one another. In your name we pray. Amen. Please be seated, dear friends. Well, we find ourselves coming to the fifth part of the sermon series on the 23rd Psalm. And you have in your bulletin an outline, and there are some blanks to fill in this morning. Lassie, I wonder if you can pass the pens. There are pens there. Thank you, Tony. We'll make them available if anybody needs a pen to fill in the blanks. This is, of course, our anniversary sermon repeat from 10 years ago, sermon series I preached 10 years ago for the beginning of our second service at Mac School, or it's moved to Mac School, I should say. We'd had the second service before, but we moved it to another venue. I have a number of times in the past shared with you my experience when I was a young curate in Australia of working in a country town called Goulburn, which is the oldest inland city in Australia. And I was posted to St. Nick's, North Goulburn, as my first appointment. And being the oldest inland city in Australia, there are many nursing homes for the elderly and a very elderly population. And as a result, a large part of the ministry of an Anglican priest in Commonwealth country, an aged and relatively old city by Australian standards, is that I had to take a lot of funerals, and I had to visit a lot of people who were dying. And on average, there was about one funeral a week. And it was really very heavy workload, because you don't just go and meet the family when the person dies. You get called when they're dying, which could be anything up to a year before the funeral. And then you visit regularly. So at any given time, there are a large number of elderly people that one would be visiting on a semi-regular or regular basis, dealing with end-of-life issues of illness and dementia and so on. So it was really a baptism of fire. And there's nothing really can prepare you for it. And I very early on noticed something. I noticed that there were some funerals that I took, and I was very green. I was so naive. I was so green. I mean, I'd been through seminary and training, but there's nothing that can replace the experience of working in the parish. And I remember, and I've shared this anecdote many times, I think, that I noticed that some funerals were different to others. Some funerals, there was joy, and there was lightness, and there was a celebration of the deceased. And in other funerals, there was heaviness, despair, depression, darkness seemed to press down upon us all. And I couldn't understand the difference. Why were some like this and some were like the other? And I struggled with this for 6 months. Being the simple bear of little brain that I am, one day it suddenly dawned on me as I went back and I tracked through the funerals and what the difference was, that the funerals where there was lightness, and of course there was weeping and sorrow, but there was also like a film of joy in the room. There was a cloud of joy. There was a peace. Those were the funerals where the person who had deceased was a member of the church and a committed Christian. And it struck me like a thunderbolt that I had observed this objectively. I hadn't come to it with the prejudice that Christian funerals would somehow be different. I had no such prejudice. I thought all funerals would be depressing and sad and difficult and terrible. And of course they are in one level. But there was a difference that I sensed in my spirit and in the affect of the people, that there was this, that the funeral is an Easter liturgy for Christians. It's a celebration of the hope of the resurrection. And you could cut it with a knife. I really felt the difference, and I noticed the difference. So it was a very significant learning experience for me. And one of the things I learned from that is that, as Psalm 23 verse 4 says, in the valley of the shadow of death, God is with us to comfort us in a very real and powerful way. So we've been tracking through the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. Listen to the language, because now we get to verse 4 and it changes. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. What changed in that little bit of literature that I just quoted to you? Let me read it to you again. Let me say it, recite it to you again. It's not in your bulletin. I'm just reciting it from memory. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. What changes in verse 4 in the literature? Yes. You're a smart lady. I knew that about you. Matthew Potka told me you were very funny. I think you have to be smart to be funny. It goes together, doesn't it? Quick wit. Exactly. The person, the voice of the literature changes from talking in the third person about he, the Lord, he is my shepherd. Therefore I shall. He makes me lie down. He leads me. He restores my soul. But suddenly it's you. Yo, I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. You are with me. So in the valley of the shadow of death, God moves from being theoretical to being personal. He becomes the personal God who is present with us. In our young adults group, we've been rather painfully and difficult in a very difficult way reading through the case for faith. It's quite hard going. And when you get to chapter 2, you encounter the problem of evil and suffering in the world. And it's written by a man called Lee Strobel, who's become famous for writing these books, The Case for Faith. The Case for Faith looks at all the great objections to Christianity, like what about other religions and what about the wars in the Old Testament and what about evil and suffering. And when it gets to the chapter on evil and suffering, he interviews a philosopher called Dr. Peter Kreeft. And Dr. Kreeft gives all the sort of classical Christian answers to the problem of evil. For example, a lot of good comes out of suffering. That's one of the answers. Another answer is free will, that God gives us free will, and therefore with our freedom we do evil. And so that explains some of the evil, a great deal of the evil and suffering in the world. And there are other sort of classic Christian answers to the problem of evil and suffering. But none of the answers really quite addresses the experience of losing a loved one or having a loved one die of disease. And at the end of the interview with Dr. Peter Kreeft, the philosopher, Lee Strobel concludes his account of the interview with Dr. Kreeft saying, Jesus is more than an explanation. So he concludes with Jesus. He gives these arguments about the problem of evil, and or answers to the question of the problem of evil. And then he says, but the final answer is Jesus, the cross. He says, Jesus is what we really need. If your friend is sick and dying, the most important thing, the professor said, the most important thing your friend wants is not an explanation about why they're suffering. They want you to sit with them and hold their hand. They don't want to be alone. They're terrified of being alone more than anything else. And I know I've experienced this when I got chopped by an illegal immigrant and I was terrified for my life irrationally. The only thing I wanted after I was stitched up was someone to sit with me in the hospital because I was terrified. I had this unnamed fear, maybe fear that the guy would come back and finish me off, but that was completely irrational. And one of the council members from the church came and just sat with me, this elderly British gentleman, and I was so grateful for his presence and for the comfort, and he sat with me until I fell asleep, and then he went home. And that meant so much to me that someone was with me in that hour of following the terror of having someone trying to cut my throat and chopping me, I'd 50, 60 stitches and stab me and so on. So it was the comfort of somebody being with me that was important to me. And so the professor said, that person in the situation is most, more than anything, in need of company, of comfort. So God has not left us alone. And the professor leaned back in his chair and he relaxed. And there was only one more thing he wanted me to know. For that, Lee, he said, I love him. I love God. I love Jesus. Now, as Lee Strobel was leaving the interview, he was being driven by a long-term friend called Mark Herringer. And as Mark was driving him back to the airport, he broke the silence in the car. Mark had been in the interview with Lee, and Mark said, it's true. What's true? I asked. What the professor said, it's true. I know it. I've lived it. Several years earlier, Mark had been shoveling snow on the driveway when his young wife had said she was going to move the car and asked him to watch their little girl, their daughter. As the car backed out, they were suddenly aware that the child was under the car, and they were thrust into the worst nightmare that a parent can imagine. Their toddler had been crushed beneath the wheel. Like the African woman who prayed for rain and yet it didn't come and her child died, Mark had known what it's like to hold a dying child in his arms. While I wasn't able to talk with that grieving mother, I could talk with him. So deep was Mark's initial despair that he had to ask God to help him breathe, to help him eat, to help him wake and sleep and function at the most fundamental level. Otherwise, he was paralyzed by emotional pain. But he increasingly felt God's presence, God's grace, his warmth, his comfort, and very slowly over time, his emotional wound began to heal. Having experienced God at his point of greatest need, he would emerge from this crucible a changed man. He abandoned his career in business and he chose to attend the seminary. Through his suffering, though he would never have chosen it, and though it was horribly painful, and though it was life-shattering at the time, he was transformed into someone who would devote the rest of his life to bringing God's love and compassion to others who were alone in desperation and grief. In the pulpit preaching for the first time, Mark was able to draw on his unique experience with God in the depths of sorrow. People were captivated because his own loss had given them special insights, empathy, and credibility. In the end, dozens of people responded by saying they wanted to know this Jesus, this God of tears. Now, other hearts were healed because of Mark's having been broken. From one couple's despair emerged new hope for many. Sometimes, and this is Mark speaking, sometimes skeptics laugh at the Bible, saying God can cause good to emerge from our pain if we run toward him instead of away from him. They scoff at the Bible saying that. But I've watched it happen in my own life. I've experienced God's goodness through deep pain, and no skeptic can dispute that. The God who the skeptic denies is the same God who held our hands in the deep and darkest places, who strengthened our marriage, who deepened our faith, who increased our reliance on him, and who gave us two more children and infused our lives with fresh purpose and meaning so that we could make a difference to others. Lee asked him gently, "Do you wish you had more answers about why suffering happens?" Mark replied, "We live in a broken world. Jesus was honest to tell us we would have trials and tribulations. Yes, of course, I'd like to understand more about why it happened." But Creed's conclusion was right. The professor's conclusion was right. The ultimate answer is Jesus' presence with us. I know that sounds corny, but just wait. When your world is rocked, you don't want a philosophy or a theology as much as you want the reality of the presence of Christ. He was the answer for me. He was the very answer we needed. I think I could probably stop there. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Not because he, some philosophical concept, is out there, but because you are with me. Even in our darkest valleys, God is there. In Israel, there was a real valley called the Valley of the Shadow of Death. It's a very deep and steep canyon, and the sun only hits the bottom when it's directly overhead at high noon. The rest of the time, the bottom of the canyon is in darkness, and thieves and wild animals may lurk there. David probably led his sheep through the Valley of the Shadow of Death as he was growing up. And when you look in the Bible, the term valley refers to all kinds of rough places in life. Joshua talks about the valley of calamity. Psalm 84 talks about the valley of weeping. Hosea talks about the valley of trouble. And this verse in Hebrew in the Psalm 23 actually means the valley of deep darkness, the shadow of death. So how do we handle the dark valleys? There are five things about valleys that we need to remember when we go through them. The first point to fill in is that valleys are inevitable. Jesus said, in this world, you will have trouble. They're going to happen. You can count on them. You might have just come out of one. You might be in one now, or you might unknowingly be headed towards one in the future years. They happen throughout life, and they come one after another. We say in English, it never rains, but it pours. In John 16, Jesus says again, in this world you will have trouble, but fear not, I have overcome the world. It's not a matter of if you'll have trouble, it's a matter of when. You're going to have difficulty, disappointment, and discouragement, and that's why we teach children to be prepared for a rainy day. There will be times of suffering and of sorrow, of sickness and of loss. There will be frustration, fatigue, and failure. It's a normal part of life. We should learn to be prepared and to take it in our stride. They're inevitable. The second thing is that valleys are unpredictable. You can't plan them. You can't schedule them. They're unexpected. They come at the worst time. This week, after a couple of weeks of not visiting Ellis, because I've been feeling very burned out recently with the last 18 months, I finally felt on Friday I must go and see Ellis and the family if they're there. And I had said to them, call me if you want to talk anytime, but of course they don't. And so I finally thought Friday, I must go. And I had lunch with another meeting I had, and then I was heading there at 1 o'clock, and guess what? I had a flat tire. So I found myself frustrated by the side of the road in this unspeakable heat and humidity, an old fat guy who has trouble getting up and down these days, kneeling on the ground and struggling with an inadequate jack. Thankfully, God sent an angel along. A Chinese gentleman walked past and absolutely insisted on taking over the task. I didn't really want him to take over. I was going okay. But he absolutely fought with me and took the wrench out of my hand and insisted on doing it for me. I said in the end, why are you so kind? Is there some philosophy of life or religion that motivates you to be so kind? And he said, well, actually, I'm the security manager of the hotel you just left. He said, I can check the camera if you like, because we found there were two nails hammered into the tire. Well, then I knew that you can't drive around on a spare tire too long. They're not designed for a long driving. So I went to the garage to get it changed, and they said, "We don't have stock." Ironically, there's another sermon in this. There were four tires on my car. Three were Dunlop, made in Japan, and one was a Chinese tire, half the price. For some reason, they'd nailed the Chinese tire, ironically. Actually, it needed replacing anyway. I think there's a parable in that somewhere. There's a lot of racism against China in the world these days and prejudice. Anyway, that being as it may, it was the Chinese tire that needed replacing, and the shop said they didn't have the stock, and I wanted the cheaper one, not the more expensive one. And they said, "You go to this tire shop." So I went to the tire shop, and of course they only had the super expensive one. So I drove around a while. I couldn't find anywhere else, so in the end I went back and paid the bill and got the new tire, by which time it was too late, and I had to go to the young adults group. So you don't time these things, you know, when that's not a dark valley, that's just a small nuisance. But these things, when difficulties happen in life, the point is they're not predictable and they don't happen when we'd like them to happen. The doctor's phone call, the freak accident, the death of a loved one, they just happen, and they often happen at the worst time. Jeremiah 4:20 says, "Disaster follows disaster. In an instant, my tents are destroyed and my shelter falls down." Reminds me of these survival programs that you can watch on History Channel these days. Some poor guy is out in the Arctic and the storm comes and his hut blows over or something, and he has to give up and go home to his cheeseburger. Number three, valleys are impartial. They're not biased. They're not against you. They're impartial. No one is immune to them. No one is insulated from the pain and the sorrow. No one gets to skate through life problem-free. We all face problems and difficulties. I remember one dear man in our church in Hong Kong who everything seemed to go well for him. He had a beautiful, gorgeous wife and gorgeous children and a good business and was living the life as an expat and went back to Australia to retire. And his wife, the love of his life, a beautiful person, my friend, contracted cancer and passed away. He was a good man. He was a good father, a good husband, but he encountered the valley of the shadow of death. Matthew 5:45, Jesus said, "It rains on the just and the unjust as well." When we go through these valleys, our first question is, why me? And yet the response could well be, why not you? Why not you? Why someone else? Why shouldn't it be you? We always say, why me? As if I somehow get a pass from the difficulties of life. But this is not heaven. Things will not be perfect here. There are going to be difficulties, and they will happen to good people as well as evil. Valleys are impartial. Number four, valleys are temporary. They have an end to them. They don't last. In this sermon series, this is my favorite because it comes to the nitty-gritty of the difficulty of life. Valleys are not a permanent location. David says, "Yea, though I walk through the valley." The valley is not somewhere where you set up your tent and camp. It's something you go through, a circumstance, a season that will come to an end. Valleys come to pass. They do not come to stay. Well, not usually. Sometimes they linger rather longer than we would like, perhaps even several years. I remember when I had a frozen shoulder, it took 2 years to get better. But eventually it passed. The pandemic will pass. Things will get better. And then one day, in 50 years or 10 years or 100 years, another pandemic will come along. 1 Peter 1:6 says, "There is wonderful joy ahead, even though the going is rough for a while down here." So don't get discouraged. Our troubles are short-lived, and there is an eternal glory that outweighs them all, the scripture says. There is an eternal glory. And pain can be productive, of course, one of the answers to pain. C.S. Lewis says God shouts to us in our pain. It is God's megaphone to get our attention. Number five, so valleys are temporary. Number five, valleys can have purpose. That is, God can give them purpose. It's not that God engineers them. People say, why does God do this to me? I don't believe that God creates evil and suffering. But I believe that God can bring good out of evil and can give purpose to that which is purposeless and pointless. The most pointless suffering of a fine young person can find purpose, or we can find purpose in it and turn it to good. like the man whose child died under the wheel of the car, and he was able to turn his life to the service of others. God can give a reason for us going through valleys, whether doubt, depression, despair, discouragement, or defeat. God wants all things to work together for good for those who love him. And that gives the valley a purpose, even if it's in retrospect looking back. 1 Peter 1:6-7 says, at the present you may be temporarily harassed by all kinds of trials. You see, he says temporarily harassed. They're not going to last forever. There will be a purpose. There will be a meaning. It doesn't mean that God did it with a purpose, but God will give you a purpose through the experience of evil and suffering. Faith is built in the valleys of life. God wants to build our character and our faith. He's far more interested in your character than he is in your comfort or your convenience. This comes as a great shock to people. We feel God should be concerned with our convenience. God should be concerned with my comfort. But he's not. He loves us so much that he is concerned for our character and for our eternal destiny. He's more interested in your holiness than your happiness. Holiness lasts forever. Happiness is fleeting. He wants to make, of course, true joy comes ultimately from the holiness of God and life with the Lord. He wants to make us more like Christ. Ephesians says we are growing up into the likeness of Christ. He wants us to develop the character of Christ, the patience, the goodness, the kindness, the faith. If God is going to make you like Christ, then he's going to take you through the circumstances that Christ went through. We too will go through our own cross. We are told to take up our cross and to follow him. Was Jesus exempted from suffering? Absolutely not. Even not all of his prayers were answered. We read that at times he could do no miracle in some places. What makes us think we're going to be exempted from that? Did Jesus go through loneliness? Undoubtedly, deep loneliness. Will we? Yes. Was Jesus tempted and discouraged? Yes. Will we be tempted and discouraged? Yes. Was Jesus misunderstood, maligned, and criticized unjustly? Yes. Will we go through those things? Absolutely. What makes you think you're any different to the Son of God? You're going to go through valleys, but God wants to build character in your life. And your faith, like pure gold, will be refined in the refiner's fire of life. I don't believe, as I said, that God causes accidents and tragedies, but he can work them together for good. He can bring life out of death and resurrection out of crucifixion. He can even use the evil that is done to us by others, turning it around and bringing good out of it by bringing character and moral improvement into the world. He uses the tragedies and the valleys of life in our lives. So what do we do in conclusion as we go through the dark valleys? Number one, I don't have enough time to dwell on this as I'd like to, but just to touch on them briefly. Number one, refuse to be discouraged. I will fear no evil. Not because I'm the meanest so-and-so in the valley, as the joke goes, but because you are with me. Your rod and your staff comfort me. Refuse to be discouraged. Our attitude of life is a choice. Not always quite that simple, I know. Sometimes depression overwhelms us against our will. But there are things that we can do. I'm always astounded by it when I see people floundering and in pain, and I say to them, you know, you need to see a counselor, or you need to do this, or you need to get help. And they stubbornly refuse to get any help. They stubbornly refuse to see a counselor. I remember when my friend Josh was here from Iraq, and there were so many things that people could do and would want to do to help him, and he would refuse any help. He was so proud. Even in his darkest valley, when he was living on the street and being bitten by mosquitoes and dealing with the heat and no air conditioning and misery and homelessness, he would refuse. If we offered to get him a flat or rent him a room, he would refuse. He would refuse help. He would accept money and a meal, but that's about it. He was so stubborn. And many people are like that. They make a choice to hold on to their misery, to stay alone in their suffering, when many want to help and offer kindness. And they don't choose to be grateful. They don't choose to be thankful and to appreciate the blessings that are coming, even in the midst of the dark valley. Now, I know it's difficult, and we don't want to fall into judgment of people whose suffering we haven't experienced. But I think there is a principle here that we have a choice to make, that we can see the glass as half empty. And I got to say, I'm the glass half empty man. I always see the glass half empty. My wife is always reminding me the glass is half full, Stephen. So I preach very much to myself in these occasions. Don't feel like I'm speaking down to you. It's not the case at all. We all need to make the choice to see the glass half full sometimes. There are many great testimonies that I can share with you, but I need to move on. The second thing that we can do is we need to remember that God is with us. David said, "You are with me. You are with me every moment." God not only promises us his strength in the valley, he promises us his presence, and that's the key for today's message. You will never go through the valley alone. You will never go through darkness alone. God says, "I am with you." Isaiah 43:2, "When you go through the deep waters and great trouble, I will be with you. When you go through the rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fires of oppression, you will not be burned. The flames will not consume you." God says, "I am with you." He will be with you every step in the valley. This verse of Psalm 23, there is this change in the voice where he speaks to God in the second person, "You are with me. You are not alone." Number three, and lastly, we need to rely on God's protection and guidance. David reminds himself that God's rod and staff comfort him. The rod was a weapon that the shepherd could throw with a heavy wooden knot on one end. It was a club, and it could be thrown or used to strike a lion or a bear and fight off an assailant. A rod is a weapon of protection and warfare. It was about a couple of feet long, and the shepherds were skilled at hurling it like a missile at anything that would attack the sheep. God was saying, "When you go through the valley, I'm defending you. I will attack your enemies. I will stand by you." And secondly, the staff was the shepherd's crook that had the curved end that would enable the shepherd to pull us back, to grab us around the leg or the neck and pull us back from the cliff or from trouble. It would keep us on the right path. He would use the staff to guide us when going through the valley. He could reach out and lead us onto the right path so we stayed safe. When we go through the valley of the shadow of death, God's protection and guidance are with us. And the shadows that we see, sometimes they're actually not as big as we think. Sometimes shadows are just that. They are just shadows. And as we remember the protection of God, not always, but sometimes they fade away. Psalm 34, verse 19 says, "The good man or woman does not escape all trouble. He or she has them as well, but the Lord helps him in each and every circumstance." So I hope that it's clear to you this morning that Christians as well as non-Christians go through dark valleys just like everybody else. We experience tragedy. We experience death. We lose loved ones. We lose jobs. We have financial problems. We have addictions. God's people have family problems. Believers go through valleys like everyone else. But there is a difference, and a big difference. And the difference is that while believers and non-believers go through the same valleys in life, the difference is that for the Christian, it's not that there's a shadow absent, but that the light is with us. The shepherd is with us, guiding us on our path. It was just as I discovered at the young priest, that at the very point of loss and death, the presence of God was felt, and I sensed it so tangibly. In my naivety, I felt like I could cut it with a knife, and yet, stupid and green as I was, it took me 6 months to figure out what the reason was. It's there in Psalm 23, verse 4. "Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you are with me." Amen. Let us turn to page 4.
Friends, let us stand and affirm our faith in the words of the Creed as we say together, we believe in one God, Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made,
of mine being with the Father.
Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit,
he became incarnate from the virgin Mary and the Holy Man.
For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scripture. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church.
We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Dear friends, let us be seated or kneel as you feel comfortable, and we will pray for the world and for the church throughout the world as Professor Duggan leads us this morning.
We will use Form 3 on page 31. Our first prayer is for the unity of the church. As we know, the church is divided. Some are Anglican, others Roman Catholic. There are Baptist, Methodists. Apparently there are 35,000 denominations now. All manner of free churches are out there. We understand how some of these divisions among your people have come about, but some of the reasons are not good. And so we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Now we're going to pray for a particular person. Joshua Maciel is leaving the 11 o'clock service to train with YWAM in Brazil. He's beginning a life of service. And so we pray for him and for us. Grant that every member of your church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
Our Father, we're delighted that Andrew is our new Archbishop and responsible for the missionary area of Macau. And so we pray for all bishops, for priests, for Stephen, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacrament.
We pray for all who govern. Ho Yat Seng in Macau and Carrie Lam in Hong Kong. These are the two SARs. And they're in a time of turmoil in some sense. So we pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Six of our people were baptized a couple of weeks ago, and one young person gave her life to Christ a few days ago. And so we pray, give us peace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favour in your sight.
We pray for Ellis and his family and his friends who go regularly to help in his distress, really. And we pray that doctors and nurses will continue to use their treatment of him. And if new knowledge is necessary in his care, that this will be made known to them. He's not the only person suffering, but he's close to the hearts of many of us as we think of him and his family. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
They may be delivered from their distress.
Yesu in the other congregation lost his wife Mariam to COVID while visiting India, leaving behind her two daughters, Angelina and Evangeline. So we pray for your comfort for all the family, and for Mariam, we pray, give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon her.
We praise you for the saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
And in a moment of silence, let us just raise before the Lord those we have on our minds at the moment who have particular needs.
Heavenly Father, you have promised to hear what we ask in the name of your Son. Accept and fulfill our petitions, we ask, not as we ask in our ignorance or as we deserve in our sin, but as you know and love us in your Son, Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." As we prepare our hearts to break bread together, let us confess our sin against God and our neighbor as we pray. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive what we have been, amend what we are, and direct what we shall be,
that we may delight in your work, and walk in your ways, for the glory of your name. Amen.
Dear friends, may Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Let us stand for the greeting of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us greet one another with the peace of Christ.
Peace be with you. Bless you.
I just want to commend the notices to you, and particularly if you'd like to join us next Sunday, we will have a free lunch at MAC. There's one of the congregants at MAC who's celebrating a life event, and they want to be anonymous, but they're buying lunch for the church. So if you'd like to join us next Sunday after the 11 o'clock service, you're most welcome to come over to the MAC school and join us for a free lunch. It says there's no free lunch. Apparently there is. So come and join us for fellowship if you have time. It will be at about 1 p.m. Next Sunday. And it's not an occasion, it's just lunch together. So most welcome to come. As you can see, we have other baptisms coming up and preparation class. If you've not been baptized and you'd like to be, please let me know. And also, we've almost locked down. We're 90% locked down on a date and a venue for a summer church camp. I want to continue. I was doing a series on the gifts of the Spirit in 2019. It was interrupted by COVID. We had to stop. We had Christmas and then we had COVID. And we never came back to finish the series. In fact, I only touched on about a third of the gifts of the Spirit, so we have a way to go. And now that we are out the other side, so to speak, I want to go back to it. And some people in the second service have been asking for prayer ministry training. How to pray for one another, for healing or for needs. And this is a really important subject because, you know, you sort of don't want people, as it were, untrained, praying for others. So I thought we could just train the whole church. And then we all know what sort of standards are and what to expect. So the theme of that camp would be spiritual gifts and prayer ministry training. So it will be, I think it will be a very enjoyable and interesting time. I'll be explaining the theology behind praying for people, prayer ministry, as well as the praxis, and we will have opportunity to pray for one another.
I hope that won't scare you off. You're always free not to participate. If you don't want to join in action songs or you don't want to join in small group prayer, you're more than welcome to go and pray quietly and meditate on your own and have a break, have a coffee downstairs in the cafe. It's perfectly fine. And we're very close to booking we've looked at several hotels. The cost is about the same for all of them, but we have a relationship with the Grand Lapa Group through the Koloan Resort. And at the Grand Lapa Hotel, the artisan one here in Macau, they have the resort swimming pool, they have the field out the back where the children can run and play, the beautiful garden, the spa, they have the Thai restaurant so they can do a Thai buffet dinner in the evening. So there's lots of advantages, and they also have great breakout rooms on the 17th floor. If you haven't seen the business meetings on the 17th floor, they're really excellent. I hadn't realized they were there until this week, and we can use those for the children's ministry. So it's, you know, I went there with Lucy last week, and we were really delighted at all the help they were sort of offering. So we need sponsorship for that, and we're going to go for it, I think. We'll probably finalize the contract this week and get the forms out to you in the coming week or two. So I'm excited about that. But a weekend's away, a good opportunity to deepen fellowship. And there are often occasions when people have life-changing experiences. There are often occasions when people can draw apart from the world and pray and grow spiritually. So I do encourage you to save the... It's going to be from Saturday morning at 9 a.m. to Sunday at 5 p.m. So do please consider coming to join us. No one's going to coerce you to do anything you don't want to do. Can come and be yourself and enjoy the fellowship of the friends and retreat to your room if you want to. All right, so that's some announcements. You can read the other announcements yourself. There's lots of things going on in the church at this time. Let us stand and sing our offertory hymn. Colin sent me a note saying this is his favourite hymn. It's one we've sort of often sung in Morrison in the past. I, the Lord of Sea and Sky, number 857. Thank you.
Let us turn to page 8 in the Green Prayer Book as we offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make our good our promises to the Most High. We pray together the offering prayer, saying, Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty, for everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. The Lord be with you.
Share in the body of Christ.
to God for the people of God, let us take them in remembrance that Christ died for us, and let us feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. As always, we do invite you to receive communion with us. You are baptized and believe in him at the Lord's table today.
Then we, the Lord Jesus, bless you and give you big glory. Daddy, the body of Christ, keep you in eternal life.
Let us turn to page 25. Those who do the will of God, they are my mother and my brothers and my sisters, said Jesus. Let us pray this Thanksgiving prayer as we say together, Eternal God, Heavenly Father,
we have graciously accepted us.
Blessing the peace of God which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and those whom you love and remain with you always. Amen. Thank you for coming, dear friends. Let us stand and sing our closing hymn as we walk through the dark valleys and the mountaintops of life. We will sing number 201. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah. and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you for coming, dear friends. Do please stay for morning tea.